Hi everyone, this is Henry from the Tynker dev team, and today we'll be making a brick breaker game with Tynker. In this game, you use a paddle to bounce a ball so that it breaks bricks. When all the bricks are broken, you win. Let's get started. Let's make a new project and customize our code palette. We won't need animation, but we will need physics. Our stage looks a little empty, so double-click on it and add a background. Let's start by making the paddle. We can import an actor from the media library. Let's use this gray button under Game Elements and rename it Paddle. The paddle is the part of the game we control. We want the paddle to follow the mouse, but it also needs to stay at the bottom of the screen. In the paddle, grab an onStart block and a forever loop. Place a goTo command inside the forever loop. Then set mouse X as the X target. For the Y target, we can see that the bottom of the screen is around -300, -325 Y. So let's use a number around there. You can see that the paddle follows the mouse, but stays at the bottom of the screen. Now let's make a ball. Again, let's import an actor from the media library. This gray circle is a nice base to make our ball. Let's make it a bit easier to see. Edit the ball, and use the Paint Bucket tool to make the ball whatever color you like. The ball needs to bounce off the paddle at the edges of the screen. We can do this using physics, but first we need to make sure physics is turned on. Go back to the stage and program it to start physics when we start the game. We won't be using gravity, so set it to 0x0. Set the paddle to be active and static. And set the ball to be active and not static. We'll also define a starting position and velocity for the ball. On start, set linear velocity to 0x0, and make the ball go to 0x0, the center of the screen. Let's program the ball to start moving downward in a random direction a few seconds after the game starts. On start, wait 1 second, then apply an impulse to the ball. An impulse of 40 should be good, and for the direction we can pick a random angle between 135 and 225 degrees. This will send the ball downward somewhere in this cone. Now, the ball bounces off the paddle, but it slows down a lot afterward, which we don't want to happen. To fix this, set the restitution of the ball to 1. Finally, we'll set the friction of the ball to 0 and its rotation style to don't rotate. You can play around with these to see how they affect how the ball behaves. Now the ball doesn't lose any speed when it collides with the paddle. Now it's time for some bricks. Let's use the drawing tool to make a brick with a few different costumes. We're going to keep it simple in this video, but you can get as creative as you want when you're drawing your bricks. Use colors that stand out from the background you chose so that the player can see them clearly. Now we're going to program the brick actor to generate rows of bricks at the top of the screen using clones. First, on start, show, set active to false, and static to true. This will prevent the brick from colliding with its clones. We'll use a for loop inside of another for loop to move the brick around, and we'll use two script variables, row and column, to represent where each brick is. For this project, we'll have 4 rows of bricks in 9 columns. The for loop on the outside will keep track of the brick's row, and the for loop on the inside will keep track of the brick's column. We'll use a goTo command with some math. The formulas for x and y are pretty similar. We take our script variable, row or column, multiply it by this second number, which is how far apart we want the bricks to be placed, and add this third number, which represents where we start to place bricks in each row and column. You can play around with these numbers to get an arrangement of bricks that you like. After the goTo command, let's make the brick create a clone of itself. After the nested loop, hide the brick. After the inside for loop, place a next costume command. This will make it so that we generate different colors of bricks each row. When the clone starts up, it should be active, so the ball can collide with it, and static, so it doesn't move. Press play, and you can see your grid of bricks appear. If your bricks look too close together or too far apart, you can adjust their size by clicking on this triangle at the top of the workspace and changing the number in the fourth box from the left. A bigger number means a bigger brick. Finally, we want to make it so that bricks disappear when the ball collides with them. In events, grab a when condition occurs handler, and from physics, grab collided with and set it to ball. Then, set active to false and hide the actor. Now, we can bounce the ball and break all of our blocks. We have a few more things to do before the gameplay is done. We'll want to make a score system and keep track of our score, which should go up when we break a brick. We'll give the player a limited number of lives and decrease the number of lives left when the ball drops below the paddle. And finally, we'll make it possible to win and lose the game. You'll win the game by breaking all the bricks, and you lose the game by running out of lives. Let's implement the point system. The player should earn points every time they break a brick. For simplicity, we'll make it 1 point per brick. Make a global variable called score. In the stage, reset the value of score to 0 on start. Then, in brick, change score by 1 when the brick collides with a ball. If you want different bricks to be worth different numbers of points, you can use something like if costume number equals 1 for each kind of brick. Finally, we want to see our score on screen. So in variables, click on score and then click add watcher. This will make a new actor that keeps track of and displays the value of score. Let's put it in the left corner. If the watcher doesn't update properly, make sure it takes the property score from the stage. Now let's make the live system. When the ball falls below the paddle, the player should lose a life, and the ball should be reset back to its starting position. Make another global variable called lives. We'll set it to 3 when the game starts. Go to the ball actor next. Let's detect when the ball falls below the paddle by checking its Y position. We can use screen bottom and the height of the ball to detect the threshold that we should check for. When the ball falls too low, change lives by -1. Now we want the ball to do the same thing as it did at the start of the game. You could copy and paste the same blocks over, or, since we want the program to do the exact same thing again, we can define a new function using those blocks, and call the function to make our code more organized. Like before, let's add a watcher for lives. Set the locations of both watchers at the start so that they line up. Make sure to bring both watchers to the front so they don't get covered up by the bricks. Now let's add code for winning and losing the game. The player should win the game when all bricks are broken. Let's add a global bricks variable to keep track of how many bricks are on the screen, and update it every time a brick is broken. Set bricks to 0 on start. In brick, change bricks by 1 each time a clone is made at the start of the game. Change bricks by -1 each time a brick collides with a ball. We'll make the game check the number of bricks each time a brick is broken, and if there are 0 bricks left, we'll make the game display a message saying, "You win." Let's make that message now. Click on Add Actor and add a new text actor. Enter our text, and rename the actor to something like Win Text. We'll set the color to something easier to see, like white, and make the font bold. We'll also hide the text actor at the start, since the player hasn't won yet. Also, set active to false so that the ball doesn't bounce off the text. Back in brick, after we change the value of bricks by -1, check to see if bricks is 0. If it is, broadcast win. We can also stop the ball from moving since the game is done, so use a stop physics command here. In the text actor we just made, when it receives the win broadcast, make it show. Finally, let's make a game over message for when the player loses all their lives. Make another text actor. Again, rename the actor, make the font and color easier to see, hide it at the start, and set active to false. In ball, after you change lives by -1, use an if-else to check if lives are less than 0. If so, broadcast lose and stop physics. If not, then reset the ball like before. Show the text actor when it receives the lose broadcast. And that's it! At this point, you have a fully functioning brick breaker game that you can win and lose. You can stop here if you want, or you can continue to add features to the game. I'll show off a few possible changes you can make. You might notice it feels kind of hard to control the ball right now. There's no way to change the direction of the ball. You can only move your paddle so that it's underneath the ball, and it doesn't fall down. We can give the player more control over the ball by changing the way it behaves when it collides with the paddle. When the ball collides with the paddle, first set its velocity to 0x0. Then we'll apply an impulse of 40. The direction is a bit more complicated. The formula we'll use is 120 times the x position minus mouse x divided by the width of the paddle. This will make it so that if the ball collides with the middle of the paddle, it'll bounce straight up at an angle of 0 degrees. If the ball collides with the left side of the paddle, it'll bounce to the left. The further left the ball collides, the further left it'll bounce. On the other hand, if the ball collides with the right side of the paddle, it'll bounce to the right. Again, the further right the ball collides with the paddle, the further right it'll bounce. Now we can control the ball a lot better. You can also add more levels to the game. At the top of the screen, click on the button that says Level 1, and click this icon with a plus on it to make a copy of our current level. If you don't see the button, click the 3 dots in the top right corner, and click on Add a Level. We want our score and number of lives to carry over from one level to the next. In the Win Text actor, after it shows itself, add a Set Level 2 command. Set the next level, and include the score and lives watchers. Then, in the stage for level 2, remove the commands that reset score and lives at the start. There's one last thing to do in level 1. Between the win text showing and moving to the next level, make the program wait until the mouse is clicked. If we don't do this, then the game will move to the next level before you ever get to see the "You win" message. Now, I'll start from level 1 and play the game. Thank you. you can see that the lives and score carry over properly to the next level. It's not very interesting to have the second level be the exact same as the first, though, so let's change some other things. We can speed up the ball. We can also generate an extra row of bricks, but make sure that the ball doesn't start in the middle of the bricks. You can also make the bricks smaller and harder to hit with a set size command. The new level is a lot harder than the old one. There's a ton more things you can do with this game. Adding sound will make the game more interesting. You could add some music to start with, but you can also add sound effects for a lot of different events. When the ball bounces on the paddle or the box, when the ball bounces on the sides of the screen, when the player loses a life, when the player wins the game, and when the player loses the game. You can also add power-ups that make it easier or harder to play the game. Maybe the power-ups can fall from the top of the screen, or maybe you get them by breaking a special brick. Power-ups can make the ball faster or slower, make the paddle bigger or smaller, or even split the ball into many more balls. Let your imagination go wild. That's all for this tutorial. Hope you enjoyed it, and thanks for watching.